my suggestion for this session today, satu jam sahaja. So first, I wanted to perhaps share with you some of your foundations. I'll talk a little bit about the definitions of online courses, awareness, personalization, okay? And second, I'd like to talk about learning materials. Okay, Dr. Zul, when I listening to his presentation this morning, I'm like, alamak, Dr. Zul already touched about C, but I guess maybe there are something that I can top up sikit ke, ataupun yang perhaps ada questions, I guess I just want to talk about that if you want. And I have number 3, 10 strategies to build personal connections with your online learners through your learning materials. Okay, rasanya tak sempat lah 10, at least beberapa je lah. Okay, and how did I do it? This is yang part yang akhir. I'll share some of the models, some of the techniques that I have used and tested, and what I have seen throughout the UM developing the MOOC micro-credential. Okay? So I may share some of the models. Okay. So let's start first. Then it's the option. I'll start this first. You know, I want to talk about the definition. Okay, so we need to be clear the terms related to online learning. What are we talking about here? Are we sharing the same thing? Or we have different conceptions of online learning, like online course. So there are some definitions, we call it MOOC, right? Massive Open Online Courses. Okay, so that's one. There is Micro Credential Course, or MC. There is Open and Distance Learning, ODL, courses. So all these three terms are what we are using here in UM. Okay? And our definitions could be a little bit different from other universities. So, this, I can just say these are all types of online courses that you will probably experience, okay, throughout your in UM. Okay, now, just a little bit. When we first want to define what is blended learning, hybrid learning, online learning, what is it? We need something to measure. Okay? So the MEPCAL, we use the Sloan Consortium 2007 definition. Sloan Consortium is based in the US, and now they have changed the name to OLC, Online Learning Consortium. So we started with the definition in 2007. They haven't really changed a lot, so I thought I wanted to share with you. Because some of us, including me, when I first researched on this topic, I'm so confused. Okay, so actually when we talk about online learning, we are referring to the 80%, more than 80% of the course content is delivered totally online. So if your course is less than that, okay, if it's 30 to 79%, we call it blended learning or hybrid learning. If it's 1 to 29%, we call it web facilitated. Now the term web facilitated dah tak ada. So basically we are using blended hybrid or online course. Okay. Okay. For this today's session, my conception of online course that I wanted to share with you is that it is an academic or non-academic course where 80% to 100% of the course content takes place in an internet-connected environment, ataupun online learning platform, okay? And delivered using e-learning platforms. Okay, so, and it is very with very limited to non-synchronous meetings between the instructor and the online learners. So basically, if you remember the definition, the 80% finger, 100% is delivered online. So we have very minimal synchronous meeting with the students. Okay. Now, who are online learners? Online learners are a group of individuals who are enrolled in an online course offered by an academic or learning institution. Okay, so how does this work in UM learning environment? Number one, I think that we can divide it into two big categories. Okay, for MOOC and also micro-credential course versus ODL course, it's a little bit different how we practice in UM. Okay, So open distance learning ODL students, they are UM students. Okay, they have matric cards, they follow UM academic schedule, they have access to UM facilities, okay, bus transportation, health services, dan macam-macam lah. And of course, access to UM lecturers. Partially self-independent learners, partially. Okay? However, students from this category, either MOOC or micro-credentials, they are not UM student. They could be anywhere from Bangladesh, Saudi Arabia, from Brazil. UM future learners, kebanyakannya, from the European countries. So, kita ada ramai UK, Dr. Zainalah dan sebagainya lah. So, they do not follow UM academic semester. So, we don't really have 14 weeks of courses. Maknanya, if they enroll or they sign up for your course, they can take as much time as they want, maybe satu bulan ke, could be satu jam ke, okay, to complete your course. Okay? And they do not have access to UM facility. Kita tak nak macam ni. Katakanlah, oh, there is a student from Saudi Arabia who took our online course. And then, after completing the course, he came and said, I need to use UM bus transportation. I want to go through UM library. Tidak, they are not UM students, so they can't have access to the facilities. And they do not have direct access to UM lecturers. Okay, so meaning that, katakanlah walaupun kita ada students coming from other universities, UTEP ke, WOU ke, siapa lah, tahu kan, dia berminat nak masuk ke kursus UM. Ya? So, tadi dia datang, ini ada doktor, boleh cerita sikit tentang research ni, saya nak dapatkan academic advice from you. No, they don't have access to UM lecturers. So, that's some of the characteristics that you need to know. Okay, so far, confusing tak? Clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Kita go on. Okay, and they also totally self-independent learners. Now, let's go to personalization. Apa itu personalization? Okay. Based on Google, based on Mr. Google, okay, personalize mean to design or produce to meet someone's individual requirement. Okay? We want to stress on the individual requirement or individual needs. Okay. In that sense, kita faham personalization meaning that if you have a service, you personalize your service only to accommodate that one person you are serving. Okay, let's take a look of personalization in other contexts before we talk about the education. So, I'm sure all of you, or maybe majority of you, have had experience traveling kan? Menggunakan kapal terbang. You see the stewardess there? Do you see the element of personalization there? Yes. When they push the card and they say, good morning sir, what do you want? Menu A, menu B? So you have the choice to tell her, I want menu B. And the person next to you, I want menu A. And some person, I'm vegetarian, I want vegetarian. So, in that sense, the service of serving food adalah personalization. Okay? So, let me bring you to another contoh. Doctors. Doctors. Okay? Can doctors not do personalization? What will happen if doctors don't personalize their treatment? Okay? We want, when we go to doctors, the first thing they do, they will assess you. Okay? They will say, okay, your weight, your height, your blood sugar, right? And then they will ask, what are the symptoms? And here is your prescription or treatment plan for you. So, one patient's treatment plan and medicine could be different from other people. In that sense, they are personalizing their services. Okay, confused tak? Okay ke? Now, what do we mean personalization in education? Okay. As an instructional designer and also education faculty member, let me tell you what it means dalam bentuk akademik. Okay. First, from United States National Education Technology Plan, they said that an instruction in which the pace of learning and the instructional approach are optimized for the needs of each individual learners. Okay. Satu lagi ialah daripada Prodigy. I think this is more practical. An educational approach that tailors learning around each individual student's needs, interests, and abilities. Okay. In other words, what they mean is that we are tailoring our services, which is the course that we are delivering, to each individual learners. Wow. Okay, the concept is nice. Huh? Usually, when we talk about personalization in education, we will come with another term or another concept called adaptive learning. So we design a system or we design instructional approaches that suits the needs of the individual learners. Okay, why personalization is important? I'm sure you can nampak the cartoon kan? Okay, if you can't see from the back, let me show it to sikit lah. So this is a this is the teacher yang depan ni, and he says, for a fair selection, everybody has to take the same exam. Please climb that tree. And you have different learners there. You have elephant, a monkey, a fish. How can everybody receive the same treatment or receive the same, walaupun this try to standardize the exam, which is normal, but they do not, the teacher does not take into account the specific or unique abilities of the learners. Okay, what do we call this? We call this one size fits all. Sekarang kalau beli baju, semuanya free size, but when you try it, okay, tak muat pun, ataupun terlalu besar. So the term free, one size fits all tu, actually kata tipu je. Okay, so that's why we don't want this. Okay, we can standardize the exam, the tugasan if we want, but we still, when we deliver the learning content, we must think of the individual learners. Okay, yang ini I want to skip lah, sebab dalam education banyak benda yang boleh kita tulis dan masukkan lah. So I'm trying to figure out apa yang kita boleh buat lah. And in instructional design, we call this learner analysis. We will have a survey and we ask the learner to fill in the survey. They will take the learning style test lah, their attitudes test lah, their knowledge related test and so on. Okay, I don't want to talk about that. But personalization in online learning could be meant these four things. Number one, meaning that you can have standardized learning environment, okay, which is conducive for them to learn. Second, the way you present the content, you can personalize that. The learning style of the learners, we can take just generic learners characteristic, and the engagement activities, we can still personalize it. The question is, when you offer your online course, you don't know how many learners will assign your course. My course, pagi tadi I check, 690 plus students. Some courses yang popular, taught by popular lecturer, those in Harvard ke, in Cambridge ke, maybe 10-100 thousands of people. How can you tailor your instruction to each of the 10,000 people in your online course? Right? This is so confusing. And this is where the practical thing comes in. How do you do it? Okay? Sorry to say, I'm a scholar, I publish in this, I do research on this, but when it comes to design, sometimes some of the design concepts, we just have to tap the beat, and you have to design your own framework based on your own experience. Okay? Now, before I left you with the options, I want to give you like a generic framework. What do we mean by connections? There are three types of connections. Okay. The first one, learner to instructor, student to lecturer connections. Okay. Second, student to student. Okay. Student A dengan student B. student A dengan group mate dia. Okay, so that's learner to learner. And this is the part that I wanted to highlight more in this session, okay? Which is learner and the learning materials. Meaning that, okay, of course kita boleh, we can look into that all three, but we don't, remember we have very minimal time to talk to the learners, so the instructional materials that we prepare for them are actually talking to them on our behalf. Okay, the learning materials that you created, videos ka, website ka, readings ka, they are representing you. So you want to do your best. You want to deliver the best quality. Why? Because they are representative of you. Malu lah kita. Video kita macam, orang kata cincai-cincai kan? Kita Universiti Malaya, number one in the in Malaysia. Number one in Malaysia tapi video macam tu juga. Okay, tak sesuai dengan kita. So, I want to give more stress on that. Okay, now, it's your turn. You have options. Which one do you want me to talk about? Number part 2, part 3, part 4. Okay. Kita ikut majority. Who wants me to talk about the part 2 first, the learning material? Can you raise your hands? Okay, tak nak. Tak boleh. Eh, ada ke? Okay. Tak ramai. Okay, what about part 3, the strategies? Agak ramai. Okay. Part 4, how I did it. I'm not interested. Okay, I'll start with number 3. Okay. Tolong tekan link number 3. Click on the So, of course, there are many, many strategies that we can use, but I just wanted to share, not 10, today tak sempat, I'll just share maybe 3 part or 4-5, we'll see, yeah? Okay. Now, these are the, if I can call it framework of the strategies that we can use, the 10. What do I mean? Number 1, welcoming environment. Core structure, conversational style, pre-instructional strategies, the graphics that you use, the analogies that you can use, mnemonics, how you signaling the text, the style of writing dalam your MC course, logical flow of ideas, and using the hook. Okay, I'll start with number 1, and then I'll stop sampai number 3 ke. Number 1, welcoming environment. Okay, again, taking into account, katakanlah kita semua naik flight sama-sama. Okay, the first thing you will notice is that when you want to go inside an airline, apa nama dia? Plane. Okay. Siapa yang greet you? Ada tak orang yang greet? Of course ada. You can see the stewardess, kadang-kadang ketua stewardess ada kat tepi pintu, and they will come. You. What do they do? They say, selamat datang. Macam-macam lah dia cakap. Can I, kita tunjuk tiket. Oh, your seat dah sebelah kanan, sebelah kiri. And then when you walk through the aisle, somebody, others who ada pula kata, oh, puan, 2F di sini. Oh, can I take your bag and put di compartment atas. Okay, so that is personalization. So we want to do the same thing with our online course. And so the first thing the learners will see is our welcoming message. Okay? The second thing that you want to introduce, welcoming message tu sama lah macam selamat datang ke kursus POA 7002. Saya adalah blah blah blah. Macam ni lah. Okay? So introduction to the course. You have to introduce the course to them. Okay? So this can be done through videos ke, text ke. That is part number 2. Okay, so this is an example of how you introduce your course. This one from Coursera. Okay, so you start with hi there, hi there, the welcoming message. No? Welcome to basic statistics. So that's a video. So they have a short video, 3 minutes to introduce about the course. And then I think this is interesting. How to navigate this course? Okay, how to navigate this course is very, very important. Sama macam kita naik pesawat, okay, sometimes you are confused kan? Kita macam, maybe you tak lah, tapi saya memang kelakar sikit. I ketuka boarding pass lah, lepas tu kita tak ingat dulu kat mana lah, aku back kat sana, kat sini. Leceh. So I need somebody who can give me instruction. If there is no person to help me, I need satu manual or satu satu buku guide that everything is there. Okay, I want to know mana my seat. I click, semua dah keluar my seat kat mana. Okay. So that's how you can do it and how you can contribute. They use the term contribute instead of how you can explain contribute to meaning the activities. Tapi they make it nice, how you can contribute instead of how you can complete this course. Not a scary skill. Okay, the word of choice. Okay, you can tell the learners what do you expect from them and what they can expect from you. But an example could be, you can tell them, this course cover only the basic. If you are interested, you can subscribe to another plan, for example. And then you can tell them, you are expected to complete each quizzes in each subtopic. Then you can see the button green. Then only you can move to the next slide. Contoh lah. Okay, this is very, very important. Kalaupun kita tak buat course secara online, our current face-to-face course must have this introduction to the course. Okay, so you must give the structure of the course dalam orang 6 kot. Yang weekly planning tu kan? Now, there are topics, so you tell them the structure. Tell them the course objectives. The tools for learning this course. Tools meaning that if they have to take an assessment, what kind of assessment they have to do. Sometimes learners are very anxious. This is, could be the first time, kan? Dia tak tahu, am I missing any assignment ke? Kenapa butang, ialah button, butang tak hijau-hijau. I mean, he has not completed something, but he doesn't know how to look for. So you can help by doing that. Time guideline for the course. You can suggest that this course can be completed within 3 hours, for example. So dia akan ada macam piece of senang sikit lah. So 3 hours during break dekat pejabat, I can take them and go through this course. Okay, course assessment. You can tell them, sometimes I have this question from people. They wanted to extend it. Contohnya, this happens only if you have your own UM students take your course online. Okay, and this I remember 2 years ago when we do the roadshow to the faculty, we said that out of the 14 weeks, 2 weeks you can ask your students to go to your micro-credential course and just tell them whatever extension of that, they can then, after week 2, they can come back to the regular spectrum and also class. So this is also important, tell them about the course assessment. Okay, so strategy number 2, make sure you have clear course structure. If you are using future learn, I think this is not a problem because it is kind of they have the template ready. Betul tak Cik Jamihan? Our winner, Madam Azanan ke tu? Ni dua hero-heroin kita. Sentiasa they have 3 ke course or 4 now? 4 courses ke dalam MC? 3? 2 and more. So memang tak habis spring lah kepada Cik Jamihan dan Madam Rosalind sebab dia orang adalah orang yang berjaya melaksanakannya. Okay, so from this structure, you know exactly what are the topics and the subtopics and when what kind of activities you're supposed to take it. So the learners, okay, tadi kita kata personalization, they can either so they can start anywhere they like. They don't necessarily have to go through introduction to instructional design. They can just go instructional design at work, for example. So there is no way you can stop them from jumping here and there. Okay? So the system, if you are using FutureLearn platform, for example, the system will automatically tell the learners what to do, the mana missing. But for those who are using not YODL, you don't have this automation, eh? So it has to be you. Okay, you have to remember. Okay, ask your learners. Kena buat yang ni dulu, topik satu, dan topik dua, topik tiga, and so on. It's kind of a little bit manual. Okay, so what do we need to know? What kind of structure we want? Number one, course introduction, getting started. Okay. So introduce the topic and subtopic, then you wrap up, and you have the week summary. Okay, so ODL people, you can also use this structure. The third, how do you write? Remember, we have very limited communication with the learners. Okay, so our videos and our content that you type in the course is representative of us, right? So you want to use conversational style. Okay, what do we mean by that? Okay, this is just an example. If you read the Google mission statement, are you attracted? Do you understand? I'm like, who cares? Whatever, Google. So their mission and vision statement are too complicated because it is written in a very formal way. We don't like this. Tak masuklah kepala kita. Macam itulah our learners. But look at this one. To bring the best user experience, macam boleh terima sikit lah kan? Okay lah. So this one from Apple. Okay, so kita boleh nampak Apple ni agak mesra berguna. Sorry, Android. Okay, but I like the Netflix. Lagi sedap. The mission statement to entertain the world. Okay? The vision statement to become the best global entertainment distribution service. Lagi simple. So, yang mana lebih masuk dalam hati kita? I personally lebih suka Netflix lah. I'm a simple person. Okay, so that's how you make your information mudah dipahami. Jangan lengthy sangat. Sikit-sikit boleh lah. Okay? So, talking about conversational communication style. Okay, try to write in short and plain language. Contohnya yang ini ya. Sequencing is the efficient 20 words. Okay, memang nampak akademik. Tapi aku pun tak faham. Susah sikit nak faham. How can you rewrite it? 14 words. Okay, nowadays you can use macam-macam paraphraser kan? You ada summarizer, ada Grammarly, ada Quillbot, ada macam-macam. Gunakan all those AI tools. Okay, selalunya students kita yang guna, why not this time kita yang guna? Okay, to our good. Okay. So, make the sentence simpler. Write it in short sentence. And try to use a lot of active voice. Okay, orang bahasa tahu ni lah. Active versus passive. Saya pun nak belajar. So let's see one example. The study on nursing entrepreneur was conducted by Rogers 2016. Yang ini kita dah biasa tulis. Because all of us as scholars kita publish macam ni lah kita tulis. But actually in students mind yang baru first time nak belajar, they don't know what is this macam alien language. Why don't you paraphrase it? Rogers conducted a study on nursing entrepreneur. Quite simple, right? Macam senang sikit lah nak faham. Right, second. Okay, this one is a quiz. Ada nama dia orang. Sebenarnya nama cik. Orang yang saya kenal je saya panggil nama. Sedia lah. Okay, number two. Can you help me? Use active voice for number two. Let me read to you. The survey instrument will be administered by the school administrators. If you want to make it active voice,
the school administrators will administer the survey instrument.
I think you get it right. Yes, exactly. Okay? You rewrite it, make it simpler. Okay, yang ni, itu faculty of medicine. Okay, faculty lain pula. Jangan buat malu faculty kita. Results will be published in the next issue of the magazine. Cepat, faculty lain. Tak, saya kena panggil ni. Sastra ada kat sini? Dia semua tak mengaku. Okay. Anyone? Volunteer? Tak ada, Dr. Zahir.
The magazine will publish the result in the next issue.
The magazine will publish the result in the next issue. Yes. Terrible. Kesian, dia kena jalan. Okay, the last one. Traces of ice have been discovered on the surface of Mars by scientists. This is faculty science. Someone from faculty science? Jangan buat malu faculty kita. Cepat-cepat. Anyone? Kalau tak ada, I'll just pick up from table tengah. Doktor. Doktor dari sains ke? Oh, sains sosial. Okay, kita dah tu. Scientist
from
Major.
Scientists have discovered traces of ice on the surface of Mars.
Okay, kita tengok. Yes! Are you from Bahasa? FPM. Okay, doctor.
SPM.
Oh, orang sains juga boleh jawab. Okay, good. Okay, so this is how you make it simpler. Okay, I don't know about you, but when I first read the academic journals, I don't understand the word. I don't understand what they're trying to say. So imagine our students also begitu, try to make it simpler for them. Okay, this is not cara untuk kita tunjuk pandai ke student. Okay, this is to help them learn better. Okay, try to use personal pronouns, but not too much. Contohnya, this topic is the fundamental principle of theory A. Next week, two more additional concepts will be introduced. Oh, macam berat lah. But if you use pronouns like we, I, us, together, they, okay, saya baca, we will explore two additional concepts next week. So it is important that you understand this fundamental principle of theory A first. How do you feel when you read this? You feel a little bit relaxed, it's not too burdensome. It is like, okay, I can do this, I can. Because you have to remember, isu utama dalam online course ialah the number of dropout students. Very, very high, 90+ percentage of students, they enroll in the course but they never finish it. And this has become the topic of discussion among scholars in education. So try to make it simpler, use pronouns as if you are talking to them directly. Okay? One more thing that you can do is talk to them as adults. Okay? Make sure you respect them, you be responsible and professional. Macam mana nak buat? Ini contoh lah yang biasa kita buat. All students are required to fill out the enclosed questionnaire by Friday before class. Ini kita biasa buat dalam kelas kita. Kecuali saya, sebab saya nak belajar. Okay, so make it more human. You say, please share your valuable thoughts. You guna banyak adjective lah. About the topic in the survey. Your opinions truly matter. Kita, student tu pun bila dia baca, kesiannya doktor ni. Dia betul-betul perlukan hikmat kita. So kita perasa okay lah. Students sampai rasa macam, kita nak tolong jawab. Okay, so that's how you have to think of your students. They are not someone who you want to like push macam tu. They are your someone you want to help. Okay?
You have to be in their shoes.
Well, you know what? Okay, number lima, use conversational bridge phrases. Contoh, selalunya kita guna what do you think of this concept? Sounds good. What does that mean to you? Can you share one example of the concept? Let's try this experiment together. Okay? You can rephrase it. Okay. Orang bahasa saya minta maaf. I don't know what it is. Tapi macam ni lah cara menulis ni kalau you want to turn it lah. Okay. If we take a broader perspective, or before we continue, let's take, you know, it's more human style. It's more conversational. Okay. It's not burdensome. It's not too formal. Tak juga informal. It's not like talking to buddies. Yeah? Tapi that's not formality. But there's also human there. So, this is much more human, if you want to see. Okay, I think I stopped there. And then, balik semula ke choice. Okay. The second ramai orang kat tangan tadi ialah Learning materials, yeah. designed and offered the online course, whatever it is, MC ke or DL ke, ada okay. Tak ramai. Okay. What about the rest of you? Are you the people who are going to introduce it later? Okay. Yeah, terpaksa dalam kerumah. All of us macam tu, don't worry. So now, let's say, actually you are very fortunate. Okay, siapa-siapa yang belum start lagi, I hope that you can get better understanding about this. And I really hope this can help. Sebab bila saya mula-mula buat my MC, I was still confused. I have to do a lot of readings, baca sendiri, so it's very painful lah. Tapi after a while, I get used to it. Okay. So, what is learning material? Dr. Zul dah sebut, but it is secara rawak, secara generik. It is any educational materials that facilitate learners' learning, and the materials can be in various forms. They could be in print-based, web-based, multimedia. Okay. So, this is what we call self-instructional materials. Okay, because self-instructional materials meaning that the learners tak boleh kacau you. Sikit-sikit tak faham baca that one article, WhatsApp you, doctor, what do you mean by this? It never happened in online course, okay? So you must make sure that your SIM, your self-instructional materials, betul-betul memberi kefahaman yang jelas kepada all the students. Now, I just want to take some moments we'll share with you what is expected from us when you conduct or when you design an online course material. It is an educational material that facilitates personalised learning. This is from MQA. Okay? The material must allow personalisation. Number two, it is developed based on sound instructional design. Yeah. But must be learner-friendly. Macam tadi lah, conversation style. Written in conversational writing style. Use simple language. Yang ke bawah tu yang sangat penting. Include learning activities, self-assessment and also feedback. This is what expected from MQA. It can also be in two forms. Okay? You can adopt existing materials. For example, any face-to-face class that you are teaching right now, you can still use the materials. Of course, dengan sedikit modifications. You can adopt. Or you can adapt existing materials. So, if you feel that something kind of off, untuk online learners, you can modify. Create original materials or any appropriate approaches. Yang ni agak susah. Okay? Even from my experience, even though I have been teaching the course that I offered, turned into online course, I have been teaching since 2010. I still have issues when I want to convert it online, honestly. Lah. Because I realize that I talk faster then I write. Bila kita bercakap, it is spontaneous, you know. Kan kita bercakap kita nampak orang, idea keluar buah-buah. Tapi kalau you have to talk to green screen masa video recording, kan? Or you have to, let's say in Google Meet kah, semua student tak buka kamera, you semua surah, cakap macam kita tak ada perasaan motivasi pun nak cakap banyak. Okay, kita jadi blank. Okay? So, creating original materials does not really mean that satu benda yang baru, yang novel, yang orang tak pernah buat. Okay, it just can also be meant that you take your course material and then you turn it into something yang ada novelty. Contohnya, kalau kita bercakap di dalam kelas secara spontan, then you use the perkataan tu and you make it formal as if kita menulis journal. Okay, and I had this idea, but I never did it. I told satu masa dahulu nama dia ada lah, now ASDPD. I told my team at that dulu, why don't we start with asking the lecturers their own punya voice recorded PowerPoint masa dia belajar mengajar dalam kelas. So then we will type balik tapi make it formal. So the formalized transcript tu will be the script that you are going to use and baca semasa video shooting for your materials. Can, boleh buat, tapi saya tak buat. Sebab saya rajin. Saya tulis sendiri semuanya, macam tulis buku. It was painful, tapi baguslah, experience bagus. And I took time to do it almost a year. Actually, dekat ADAC masa tu, we were the first batch yang buat 5 orang. Lepas ni, Dr. Azhar, Dr. Zahir, Dr. Amira. Okay, kita orang nak testing the water. So, kita try dulu dan kita rasa dulu Allah susah ni. And we learn from that experience, kita cuba singkatkan masa. What we did wrong, kita nak cuba ajar orang, okay, jangan buat macam ni, you buat macam ni, you laju sikit. So now I think it can be completed within 3 or 4 months, macam tu kan? Because through our experience lah, so kita orang dah test dan pretty well. Don't stop. InsyaAllah boleh, okay? Okay, and there's also intellectual property that you need to think about. If you are using materials from YouTube, for example, cite properly. Tapi I think ADAC ada their own guideline, macam the gambar-gambar that you took yang ada license, try not to use it. You can talk to ASDPD people, maybe they can redraw. Boleh tak, Liz? Ha? Dia masih buat lagi macam tu? Redraw balik gambar eh? Oh, dia orang buat. Masih baik. I remember in one of the courses, I can't remember which course, ada satu seorang pesyarah tu, dia nak buat tentang rambut, buat gambar rambut, right? Macam tu lah. Tapi, we have to redraw gambar rambut tersebut. Sebab kita tak nak ada isu copyright. So, you have to berjaga-jaga in that sense. But don't worry, ASDPD people, they're very good with this. Now, kita bercakap tentang the various forms of learning. Imagine yourself in class, or maybe in my session, dengar je, I cakap. Cakap, you dengar. There is no interaction. Okay, and there is no, apa kata, various forms of delivery. So, sama juga with the online learners, they also need to be stimulated intellectually. How you do this? You can try, mix and match beberapa jenis learning materials. Okay, you can mix dalam satu topik, ada sedikit teks, ada sedikit video. Not too much, ya? Lepas tu, subtopik yang seterusnya, you use images or manipulatives. Okay, what are those? Just reference. Okay, yang ni kita dah biasa, text and also videos. So, if you are using, if you are doing MC or MOOC, the platform dah siap-siap ada template begini. Which means that if you have video, they will have transcripts automatically written. Which means you got automatic pun. You can upload the transcript, nanti dia masukkan dengan template lah. Okay, so you can do this one form and kind of kita dah biasa with this. But if you want something yang lain-lain sikit, you can try to use infographics, posters. I use this infographic and I took it from outside, but I cite properly lah. I say citation, da-da-da-da. So, try to pelbagaikan your material supaya dia don't tak boring. Okay, have you heard about manipulatives? Apa itu manipulatives? It means that benda yang kita boleh manipulate. Okay? So, contoh. Okay. Contohnya, in my course, there is an activity where I ask the learners to share their drawings outside of the learning platform. I use Padlet, so I give a link dalam dalam my course, and when they click on the link, they can immediately go to Padlet. So Padlet is a manipulative in that sense. If you want, you can do that as well. Nak mempelbagaikan. Okay, so I think that's it. Okay. Can I share a little bit the part 4, how I did it? Is that okay?
Yes.
Siapa yang tak okay?
Okay.
I'm trying to personalize the session. Not the top. Okay, part 4. How I did it. Yang ini. Okay, I think when we first pioneered the MC at UM, dah banyaklah sesi-sesi apa kata brainstorming, sesi sharing-sharing, sesi membawang semua tentang our experience. So I think that these are some of the models that we have tested after like almost a year. You can, number one, choose whether you want to develop your course individually or in a group. There are the pros and cons. Okay. I'll show example. Okay, so you can choose now. Sometimes, for me, individually, created lessons easier. Tapi kalau working in groups could be better juga. So I don't have that experience, Raza. Number two, you can choose whether you want to design academic course that you're teaching right now or something non-academic at all, but you have passion. Okay. Number three, you must get support. And the last one, you must get help. If you want help. Okay, saya abadi kan hero dan heroine kita dalam slide because they have been doing this very committed. So Madam Razanon dan juga Encik Jamian. They have two courses. Let's learn Portuguese. Satu lagi, let's learn Thai. They are the first people, the first course that we offer. Okay, and they do it individually. Okay, perhaps after this, masa makan nanti bolehlah tanya-tanya apa pengalaman dia orang nak buat. Bukan satu tapi dua. Bukan dua, ada lagi satu akan keluar, betul tak? Dia cakap iya. Dia belajar. Okay. So, for me, working individually is cepat sikit than working in groups. One is because I don't have bidang saya walaupun sama, tetapi I have colleagues yang have different school of thoughts for me. So, kita macam bila nak present the material tu, I will say, I suka constructivist kan. Yang dia suka buat individu sikit. So, susah sikit lah nak bergerak kat situ. Okay, and I don't like to tunggu-tunggu orang. Like, you upload your material, baru I buat. I think it's a hassle lah. Tapi, there's also people who have done it. Kalau ada orang di sini, Dr. Samsul Rizal dan Dr. Nur Faizal, mereka bersama-sama buat course ini. Okay, so, and I think this course, personally, I really appreciate their doing this because when I give talk, people always tanya, you're from Malaysia, so why do you offer something like how to learn English? Why don't you do that? How to learn Bahasa Melayu, for example. So, this is one course that really talk related to our culture. Okay, so, working in groups, boleh tanya Dr. Azhar ataupun kita dah kazah buat berlima, pernah mistaken ke? Berlima, okay, what are the pros and cons? Kena cerita nanti masa makan. Sekarang tak boleh. Okay, so if you want some, you're thinking about apa lah yang I have to do. Okay, what courses I can come up with? I can tell you some of the options you can think about. Number one, of course, the current course that you teach. I teach instructional design, my MC is also on instructional design. Sebab saya nak rehat sikit lah. On week 2 and week 3, I ask my students to go online. Tapi, yeah, sometimes it didn't really work lah because you have to really tanya budak-budak bila they come back on week 4, you must ask them, have you go online? You kena berikan bukti yang dia dah ambil my course online. Okay, otherwise it didn't really helpful. Okay, if you have any foundational courses or prerequisite course, contohnya research method 1, kita ada 2 research method. Research method 1, research method 2. So you can create research method 1 course online. So that way you tak payah susah-susah ajar sebalik semula the foundational concepts. Whenever your students, your advanced students have problems, they can always check on the foundational course like this. Okay? If you have training, you can have training based courses. For example, what I can think about ialah contohnya research ethics application di UM. UM REC. UM Research Ethics Committee kan? UM REC, if I'm mistaken. When I was doing my PhD dulu, I have to apply for this research approval. I have to go through training online to make sure that I understand the research ethics. So I have completed it. I print the certificate and give it to my supervisor and the faculty will approve me. Then only I can go collect data and so on. So you can do such things if you want, if there is something let's say in your own faculty that have like similar characteristics, you can do it. Okay? I have that experience when I was so when I was studying in US, pretty banyak juga lah belajar, banyak sangat lah belajar. So I was me and a few friends, we were hired as instructional designers by the student help center. So our task was to design a learning a tutorial system where the new recruits, macam new doctors, new nurses yang nak masuk to the student health center, they have to go through the online training, bring the certificate, bring it to the superior. Then only they are going to orientation day one. So it has to be done before they go for work. Okay, so if you have something like that, you can use it. Okay, or something that very dear to your heart, yang macam, I want the world to know this. This is very important. Okay, so you can come up with your own courses, really like that. Okay. Now, these are some of the courses yang berbentuk topics dear to my heart or prerequisite or foundational. It may not be academic. This is from Coursera.com. The science of well-being. Okay. Everybody must know about the concept of well-being, so you have created one. Okay. Learning how to learn. Ini pun penting juga. You want to prepare your online learners, so you ask them, okay, go through this learning how to learn. So, untuk student-student yang tak berjaya dalam thesis tu, berapa banyak kali masuk jawatan kuasa rayuan faculty, ask them, masuk dalam kursus macam ni. Okay? So, you can create one for them. Successful negotiation and so on. So, there's a lot of things that you can think about if you don't have any idea. Nah, getting somewhere. Ni yang orang excited sangat tadi tu, pagi tadi tu, kata Zula ni. Financial support. What kind of support do we mean? We mean financial support and technical support. Okay, when I first do, when me and my colleagues do create MC, we were puzzled. Alamak, rupanya banyak budget juga yang kita perlukan. Bukan banyak apa macam, we were in ADEC at that time, so we need studio, we need to hire people yang boleh video shoot. Kalau tak, kita rasa susah kan, we have to learn the video shooting software and whatnot, and we don't focus on the content much. Okay, so you can get financial support from your department, your faculty, or your center. If I'm not mistaken, FBL, am I correct? Those in FBL, kalau saya salah, betulkan. If I'm not mistaken, they have some funding that you can apply to help you develop the MC course. Or they give you someone to help you. If I'm not mistaken, kau mana berjaya lakukan ke tidak? Ya, betul. Oh, ada. Faculty FBL harta ni. Maxine also, I think ada. Ada ke? Tak ada. Salah orang, sorry. Yang ada kat bawah. Okay. You can also think of a grant. Okay. Dulu-dulu, we have the teaching and learning grant. We give grants for those who wanted to create online courses. So now, the specific grant tu maybe dah tak ada. Okay. What you can do is you may want to apply macam PRGS, prototype grant. Something to PRGS ataupun you want to use yang mostly sediakan tu terkeluar pula dalam kepala waktu ni, but there are some community grants also that you can also apply under the MCARES. Manalah tahu it could be something that related to you and you can create it. Okay. Number two, you will need help with technical support. Okay. So you need instructional design consultation. If you're not familiar with how to start breaking up your courses into topics and subtopics, go to the instructional design consultant, ADEC lah, or ASDPD. Okay, they will help, of course. So if you need help with video shooting and editing also, you can hire someone or you can get help from the central to help you with. And talking about video shooting, I remembered many of us who have already created MC course, as much as we can, we try to do the video shooting in the natural environment. Okay, I don't have the gambar now, but I remember Dr. Zahid shooting dia dengan nyamuk-nyamuk rimba elmo. Okay, so lagi satu, I remember those from pharmacy, if not mistaken, Cik Anis tahu. The team went to pharmacy kan, tempat simpan ubat, something like that. and their lab, because the course is about how to create drugs, something like drugs taken. Okay, so try as much as possible. Tak nak boring kan? Macam my course, I have ada natural setting lah for me. So my background is green screen. So I don't go out. I go to the studio only. But my colleagues yang ada kursus yang hands on. Yeah, the lab, you can shoot kat dalam the lab, biar nampak macam real. Okay, this are some of the gambar-gambar kenangan lah. I just want to bring this out, okay? So, you can see that we shoot bila-bila sahaja. Dan whenever perlu, di jaminan ni dekat studio, in bilik, pusuara, ni farmasi dekat lab. Itu green screen tu saya lah tu. Ini dekat bus station. Okay, so if you want to make it natural, kita boleh try this environment. And don't worry, I wanted to also give appreciation to once upon a time my team called EDEC. Okay, so they are very committed, inshallah. You don't have to worry, they are here to help you. Nampak kita orang bermain, kita tak nampak, tapi nampak tak orang yang kat bawah pokok tu, dia shoot kenderaan KDM tu dekat bawah pokok. Okay, so dia committed. Dekat atas bumbung pun kita pun nampak juga. So they bring the crew, kita shoot ke atas bumbung. Yang ini kenangan saja lah. Kenangan naik van, bawa semua barang-barang nak shoot kat natural setting. Okay, Anis kata jangan cakap banyak. Saya conclude with this. Help, you really need help. When I did this, I really need help. Because I'm a person yang banyak kerja, lain yang buat, and I senang sikit nak get this one. But, so I have one person to help me, could be your student. Okay? If you have a research assistant, you can hire them to help you. Okay? If you have a project manager, lagi bagus. Siapa-siapa yang duduk dekat center, you can hire somebody to help you. Medicine ada, doktor. Medicine dia ada staff.
Cik Hais.
Ya?
Cik Hais.
Medicine.
Welcome to medicine, ya. Yeah. If I'm not mistaken, you have like instructional designer kan? Ataupun... You have mana-mana fakulti yang bertuah nak nampak macam mana kan, dari fakulti tak berkuasa kan. Mana-mana yang bertuah tu, dia orang ada their own center ataupun team to help other members of the faculty. Cari maklumat tu, or you can propose to your dean, kata I need this. Actually, it is KPI of the dean. So they are supposed to be helping you. Kan, bilang koreklah mana-mana tu yang ada to hire assistant. Okay. Now that you have the money, what are you going to ask them to do? They can help you with a lot of things yang kecil-kecil bengit tu. They can help you research the content. Okay? Find pictures yang suitable, videos ke, because sometimes you need some ideas. They can check the language structure. Tapi sekarang kita dah ada AI, you don't have to worry sangat lah. They can help you develop quizzes. This is something yang agak sukar sikit for me. Because my course is very macam hands-on sikit, so susah for me to come up with questions yang suitable for quizzes. So my RA helped me with that. So I betulkan, dia dah cari sikit, dia bagi proposal to me, I just choose and buat. And upload the materials to the portal. You think it's easy sometimes kan, macam senyap je. Eh, dia kata klik dah upload. But actually sometimes dia leceh sikit lah. Okay, kalau kita tak biasa with the platform, it'll take time. So this person can help you. So if you want help, cuba cari help from this kind of people. Okay, I think that's it. And I want to, if we have time, kalau ada questions, you can always ask me. If not, ramai orang yang ada experience, pakar-pakar dari sini, we can share experience. Okay, ada questions ke? Ataupun sharing ke, ya doktor?
So, UM is like just me doing it. The
academician
get, at least the department
should
get like part of the budget, right?
Because, okay, let's say all the students, they have to pay, right? So my question is, will UM give part of the percentage to the department.
Okay. Let me get back to your question tadi. All students will pay.
I know.
Okay, the payment too differs based on which course, which online course you choose. If you are doing MOOC, the concept is the students learn for free. They don't pay anything. It's about Dr. Murbiha just now, pagi tadi, dia kata, we should charge online learners more than the face-to-face learners because of the cost. Okay, so in MOOC, students learn for free, but they have to pay if they want to get certification. Okay, bila dia bayar, say, £30, baru dia boleh dapat certificate. For ODL, they pay awal-awal lah, they pay masa dalam bulan. For micro-credential, lebih kurang sama dengan MOOC juga. Sama. So, micro-credential, the students have to pay upfront untuk complete time, maybe 3 courses yang stack together. So, in terms of distribution of funding, I'm not a person in charge. Fazal?
The best is to ask your dean. Some faculties, they pay their own staff. The faculty pays.
There's a lot of benefits of doing this. This is not a roadshow, but I'm just sharing from my own personal experience. Memang susah, struggled in the beginning. You can ask people who have done it. Susahnya, ya Allah, stressnya, geram sangat, tak sia-sia. Tapi, when you publish it, you feel satisfaction and kind of achievement. Now, I can stand in front of you and proudly say, I have one course already. And when I give training or share it to people, I have got more things to share. Okay? And satu lagi, I had tak nampak benda ni in the beginning, but when people took my course online, some of them wanted to go through the trouble to contact me through email and thank me personally. Oh, kata semua. Ini kalau orang daripada USF tiba-tiba kata, Doktor, I took your course, it's really helpful. Kita rasa macam berbunyi, kita nak terbang. Macam, oh, seronoknya. Kita lupa dah semua struggle. And secondly, you can get research collaborator as well from overseas. Remember, as I mentioned, di umfuturelearn.com, our audience lah daripada Europe. Jadi, kita can get emails from the Europe and say, Dr. Farrah, you're doing this, what do you think you want to join my project on this? You can get new collaborators. That's from my own personal experience. Huh? Susah sikit, tapi insyaAllah berbaloi at the end. So, ada timbal dan balas lah, pro and cons. Thank you for your question. Ada lagi siapa-siapa yang nak share or tanya? Ada. Semua dah siapa nak balik. Okay. So, if you have any concerns ke, nak tanya ke, insyaAllah, I will be available di sini ataupun orang-orang ASDPD can also always answer your question. InsyaAllah, we'll jumpa again, and I really hope that this is something beneficial for you and give you some motivation to start something with your arts today. Yeah? Thank you so much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.